Good morning. Welcome you all in the name of Christ. So good to see each of you as we gather to worship on this Transfiguration Sunday, a time that we remember and meditate on the gospel account of Christ being transfigured on the mountain with his disciples. If you are visiting with us, we welcome you in the name of Christ, and we are delighted that you've joined us today for worship. We pray that you would hear a message that would inspire you and encourage you, and that you would feel the love of Christ here in our fellowship at the chapel. Now, today is a new member Sunday, and so we welcome 24 new members 14 adults and 10 youth. And so I'm going to read their names. And if I know some of them could not be here today, but those that are here today, we're going to ask that you would stand together when I call your name. So George and Pat Waterworth, George and Pat. Some of them may be in the 11 o'clock service as well. Doug and Amita Sherwood with daughters Davina and Roslyn. Okay. John and Shirley Aquino. I believe they're in the 11 o'clock service. Steve and Katie Wilson and son Andrew. There we go. Absolutely. James and Joanna McFadden with daughters Abigail and Megan. Absolutely. Wes and Anna Smith with their sons, Rand, Philip, and Wynn, and baby on the way. Kenny and Laura Goodman with daughter Kate and son Matthew. Wonderful. So we certainly praise God for our new members. And after the service is over, we're going to invite you to stand in the narthex with Pastor John and me, and you'll have an opportunity to be greeted and welcomed by the entire congregation. And then also right after this service, I believe that some of our membership ambassadors are going to escort our new members over to Chapel Hall for our brunch. And of course, all of you are invited to make this brunch a part of your lunch plans today. Remember, this Wednesday is Ash Wednesday. It is the beginning of a season we call Lent. And we will actually have two services this year for Ash Wednesday. So we'll have one at 12 noon and another service at 6 p.m. And both services will involve the imposition of ashes. So you're invited to start your Lenten season with us here at the chapel. And then the following Wednesday, the 17th, we're going to begin our new break night offerings. We have three offerings this year for you guys to choose from. And that is with other offerings that we have during the entire week, along with two Sunday school classes, one of which meets immediately following this worship service over at the Care Cottage. So we have a lot of opportunities for our congregation to be engaged in Christian education and discipleship, and it's a great way for us to grow in our faith with Christ and our fellowship with one another as well. So as we prepare our hearts for worship, let's stand and greet each other in the love of Christ. You may be seated.
We will not be praying for the Super Bowl. I'm just kidding. At least I won't be in here anyway. But let us go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Almighty, most merciful God, we ask that you would come into this space this morning. We ask that you would come and dwell with us, sitting down and making yourself known to each of us. Lord, open our eyes to see you in this place and open our hearts to your infinite love. O God, creator and preserver of all mankind, we humbly beseech thee for all sorts and conditions of men, that you would be pleased to make thy ways known unto them, thy saving health unto all nations. Lord, we pray for the Holy Church, that it may be so guided and governed by your good spirit, that all who profess and call themselves Christians may be led into the way of truth and hold the faith in unity of spirit, in the bond of peace and righteousness of life. Lord, we thank you for your Son, the beloved Jesus Christ. Thank you for his courage to say yes in order that we may have life. Father, as we approach the season of Lent, gently shake us and make us aware of what needs to be shaken away from our lives in order that we may bring the kingdom to this earth. God, I pray for courage, just as you are courageous in saying yes to the cross. Jesus, we thank you for your love and for your life and showing us beautiful ways to interact with the world. God, as we remember your transfiguration, bless those who have gone before us. And God, that you would make us instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, let us sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is discord, union. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. Grant that we may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, and to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, and it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Almighty God, in giving us dominion over this earth, you made us fellow workers in your creation. Give us wisdom to reverence so to use the resources of nature that no one may suffer from our abuse of them, and that generations yet to come may continue to praise you for your bounty through Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray for those here in this congregation. We lift those up who need physical healing. We lift those up who need restoration. Lord, we pray for all of the marriages here in this room, strengthening them, bringing them closer to you. Lord, we pray for those who are alone and are grieving the loss of loved ones. We ask that you would grant comfort and peace. And today we especially remember Don Weaver, Bobby Mumford, Tom Hurst, Lynn Cook, Braden Monaco, Ann Vanderwalk, Lib Palmer, Andy Thomas, Hans Peter and Karen Feddersen, Lindsay Grantham, Steve McKenzie, Adelaide Geern, Dot Evans, Joanne Baker, and Florence DeSandy. Lord, we lift all of these things up in your precious name of Jesus Christ, and together we pray as you have taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from Luke 9, 28 through 36. The Transfiguration. About 8 days after Jesus said this, he took Peter, John, and James with him and went up onto a mountain to pray. As he was praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became as bright as a flash of lightning. Two men, Moses and Elijah, appeared in glorious splendor, talking with Jesus. They spoke about his departure, which he was about to bring fulfillment at Jerusalem. Peter and his companions were very sleepy, but when they became fully awake, they saw his glory and the two men standing with them. As the men were leaving Jesus, Peter said to him, "Master, it is good for us here. Let us put up three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what he was saying. While he was speaking, a cloud appeared and covered them, and they were afraid as they entered the cloud. A voice came from the cloud saying, "This is my son, whom I have chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, they found Jesus was alone. The disciples kept this to themselves and told no one at the time what they had seen. Here ends today's scripture lesson. May God add his blessing to the reading and hearing of his holy word.
Let us pray. Oh God, who before the passion of your only begotten Son revealed his glory upon the holy mountain, grant to us that we, beholding by faith the light of his countenance, may be strengthened to bear our cross and be changed into his likeness from glory to glory through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. On this Sunday of the Transfiguration, the last Sunday after the Epiphany, we are again reminded of the divinity in Jesus, the awesome majesty of the incarnate Word made flesh, dwelling among us as one of us. If you'll recall, Epiphany began last month, as it always does, with the Holy Family being visited by the wise men bearing gifts for the Christ. Then on the following Sunday, we read about the baptism of our Lord, who was joined by the Holy Spirit, descending as a dove, and the voice of God the Father declaring Jesus as his Son, in whom he is well pleased. The next Sunday, we saw the first miracle of Jesus at a wedding in Cana, when Jesus turned water into wine. The next Sunday, we heard the first sermon of Jesus preached to the hometown folks in Nazareth, in which he announced himself as their long-awaited Messiah. And last Sunday, we witnessed the reaction of the Nazarenes, who were unable to accept Jesus as their Messiah, let alone their Lord and Savior. And today, Epiphany ends on a holy mountain, with a vision of the resurrected Christ and the voice again of God Almighty, directing our attention from distractions of our own making and focusing our hope on our one true Savior and Lord. Now, to understand what today's account of the Transfiguration is all about, we need to back up a bit to just after the feeding of the 5,000, the only miracle that's contained in all four Gospels, when Jesus asked the disciples who they think he is. Peter, speaking for all the disciples, professes Jesus as the Messiah. Jesus then blesses Peter, but then reminds him that he didn't figure this out on his own, but this knowledge was given to him through the Holy Spirit. Then Jesus proceeds to explain to the disciples exactly what kind of Messiah he was going to be. Not the conquering hero they had hoped for, but a suffering servant who would die for the sins of the world. Then as soon as Peter realizes the impact of what Jesus is saying, he tries to talk Jesus out of it, and Jesus rebukes him harshly. Then we see the disciples and Jesus on their way to Jerusalem, and Jesus hears the disciples quarreling about which of them is going to be greatest in the kingdom of heaven. At this point, Jesus must realize how alone he really is. He's about to face the crisis of his life, which he knows will end in his own death. And the disciples, his closest friends, are of absolutely no help or support to him. Jesus knows they need something to direct their focus on him as their Savior, and not on themselves or anything else, especially their fears. He knows they need something more than just mere knowledge that he is the Messiah. He knows they'll need something in their memories to hang on to when the going gets tough. Jesus knows they need something more, something like the Transfiguration. So he takes the three leaders, Peter, James, and John, up to a mountaintop. Then the disciples fall asleep. That's no surprise. They were always doing that, and usually at an inconvenient time. But maybe it was a rigorous mountain climb to the top. And they awake, and they see a vision that is indescribable. Jesus, in his resurrected, exalted body, speaking with Moses and Elijah. Moses representing the law, and Elijah representing prophecy. But why? And for what purpose? The disciples clearly needed some fortification to prepare them for that journey they were going to take to Jerusalem and to prepare them for the cross. So they were getting to witness Jesus in his exalted state, but also talking to what must have been for all of them their heroes, Moses and Elijah. But what about Jesus? Did he need something extra at this point? I mean, wouldn't it be ironic that the event in his ministry, seen as the epitome of Christ's divinity, the clearest and most magnificent manifestation of God breaking through from the flesh, Jesus in his glorified body that words can't describe, that at this moment on the mountaintop, Jesus is also displaying his humanity, every bit as human as any of us. And you might ask, how could this be? What is there of Christ's humanity here in the Transfiguration? Think about where Jesus must have been emotionally just before this. He had to realize that the disciples were not exactly understanding and supportive of the sacrifice that he was going to make. And in fact, we know that they'll abandon him at his darkest hour. He knows he won't be able to count on these disciples, and yet he doesn't give up on them or abandon them. On the night of the crucifixion, Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane, pouring out his heart to God the Father. But now, with half of his public ministry still to be performed, to whom does Jesus turn for comfort and support? Could it be that Jesus, in his humanity, needed this transfiguration every bit as much as the disciples? Maybe Jesus needed his own pep rally to prepare him for Jerusalem. Think about it. The transfiguration happens right at the midpoint of the public ministry of Jesus. In the language of the game that many people will be watching later on today, this is halftime for Jesus and the disciples. And what is halftime for a football team? It's the time to regroup, refresh, and remember and consider what we did right and wrong in the first half, to prepare ourselves to win and succeed in the second half. The second half for Jesus and the disciples is to take this mountaintop momentum from the Transfiguration and then use it as the boost they need to progress all the way to Jerusalem. where Jesus will do nothing less than face off against the sin of the entire world. I suggest today that each of us think of this year, 2016, regardless of our age. Think of this year in our families, in our church, and in our nation as the halftime we need to be inspired, focused, and transformed with our Savior to take us to the end of our second half, all the way to our Jerusalem, where we meet Christ at the foot of the cross. This year is our halftime, when we need to get our act together and come together as brothers and sisters in Christ, here at the Village Chapel and with the worldwide body of Christ. And whether you consider yourself ahead or behind at halftime, your coach is here to remind you that the game's not over yet. You can win the first half and still lose the second half. Everything depends on what happens in this second half as we, with Jesus, make our way to the cross. And how are we going to do that? We can begin by considering what we've done wrong in the first half, how so many of us have just been too busy, as Peter was on the mountain, just to listen to Jesus. When our families are young, just starting out together, husbands and wives working long hours, and with little time left for their children and each other, then the families can fragment, and the home is no longer an escape from the pressures of this world, all in the pursuit of spending and borrowing. And then we overstimulate our minds so that we can't hear the voice of the Holy Spirit with the TV, radio, DVDs, CDs, and PCs going all the time. And with the news broadcast 24 hours a day, our minds are literally jammed with little room left for communion with Christ. Even our weekends offer little time for recreation. How often on Sunday nights have we been exhausted, unsettled, and unprepared for the week ahead? Consider how little time we've spent in nature, reflecting on God's natural wonders, instead of spending our time in trivial amusements, all in the pursuit of keeping busy. And even when we meet for spiritual fellowship and worship, how much time is spent in gossip and small talk, leaving us with troubled consciences and unsettled emotions. And as Christians, instead of sharing the saving grace of Jesus Christ with those who need to see what that looks like, we can crowd our lives with so many good causes that we have no time to seek power from Christ, depending instead on our own strength and resources, and sacrificing our health and our families for the good of the cause, all in the pursuit of staying busy, anything and everything to distract ourselves from the guidance and direction of our Lord and Savior. What God says to Peter on that mountaintop, he's saying to us today, be still. Don't crowd your life with the non-essentials. Don't distract yourself to death. Instead, listen and pray. And our Lord and Savior will show us the way out of this world and into the next, where he has prepared a place for us. Can't we find the time in this busy second half that awaits us just to listen to Jesus? Let us pray. Heavenly Father, in you we live and move and have our being. We humbly pray you so to guide and govern us by your Holy Spirit, that in all the cares and occupations of our life, we may not forget you, but may remember that we are ever walking in your sight through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And now let us stand and affirm our faith by saying the Nicene Creed.
We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father, and he shall come again with glory, to judge those who live and the dead, whose kingdom shall not have any end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord and Giver of all life, who proceeded from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. And I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Before we begin Holy Communion, I want to remind everyone that's present this morning that communion is open to everyone who professes Christ as our Lord and Savior. The chalice has two sections. The larger one is the wine and the smaller one is the juice. And now let's prepare our hearts. When the hour had come, he sat down and the 12 apostles with him. Then he said to them with fervent desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I will no longer eat of it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took the bread, and he gave thanks, and he broke it. And he gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, he also took the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you. As often as you shall drink of it, do so in remembrance of me. The table of the Lord is prepared before you. You please stand and receive the benediction. And after the benediction, we would ask that our new members would join Pastor John and me in the narthex to be received. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. And the blessing of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.